So here we have a cutting board that we may want to put a logo on the bottom of. So I've got my pencil marks where I want to place this. I'm just going to put some double-sided tape on the back to hold this in place, just so that as we cut, nothing moves. Now, plate rests on here, and the friction of the non-slip mat on the bottom just keeps it in place nicely. Now it's my job to make sure that this is lined up vertically with my little slots. I bring my reticle down and get that lined up with my pencil mark in the center. So now I know the center of my cut window is perfectly aligned with the center of my pencil mark. Now, I think that's stable enough for me to be comfortable cutting here, cutting in just a light engraving. If you want it more stable, you can obviously get your clamps in here and clamp things more firmly. Now, we're not going to want to bow plate, so we don't clamp really tight. We've got enough friction on the bottom of this to hold it in place for most scenarios. So quickly, I'm going to change to an engraving cutter. And I'm going to want to make this into a new workspace. So this is my plate center ref workspace. I'm going to give this a name that's custom to my logo. So I've got a logo that's like a little RPW logo. So I'm going to duplicate this. You'll see here, this is the workspace I was in. We're going to move to this one and just call it rename plate center RPW logo. So now I can readily search for this whenever I want to place this in the center of my plate and cut it. This is just immediately available for me. And instead of remaining in my previous one, I'm going to go into this one. So now we have the center all defined. Let's go and import our file, our little logo we want to place. Go back out one, and then I got some maker's marks here. That one looks good. That's centered exactly where I want it. So I can place that anywhere. I can use the position scale, whatever I want. I'm just going to place it in the dead center as is. Now we can go straight to cutting. So I've just changed to an engraving cutter. Instead of telling it to Z-touch, I'm just going to set that because I've changed cutters. It's going to ask me to do that again. Now it's going to go all the way down. It's touching the wood inside that little gap. Just make sure it's not touching the top surface of plate itself. So by touching off onto the surface of the wood, I'm ready to just enter the exact value that I want to cut into the wood. So my engrave depth makes sense now, instead of having to add whatever the height of plate is. And then the only other thing is I've pulled origin back far enough that the little pressure sensor on the bottom here is touching the flat surface of plate down here. So cutter's touching the wood, pressure sensor's on plate, you're all good. If you've deformed things in some way, you can also come up over here and get a little touch off in the corner there. But this is the normal position you'd want to be doing that. One other thing, when you move plate to the side, just make sure your cutter's retracted all the way so you clear the actual solid material. This is especially important when you're using long cutters for corner rounding or deep pockets. Just make sure that you're not going to cut into either the aluminium or the top surface, the tape field. Right, with that touched off, I now set my other settings to zero. My depth is set to engrave, and my file, which is now kind of baked into plate because my workspace is called plate RPW logo, this is always available for me to cut at exactly that center point. So from this point on, this logo becomes super efficient to cut because it's always there ready to go with plate. So let's get cutting. Now the process to cut it again is super straightforward. So with that, I'm ready to go. So you'll see my file is instantly available on plate, ready to go. And I just start cutting again. Okay, for this little example, we're going to do a 5-hole pattern, sys32 hole pattern along the edge of both sides. So I'm going to have it centered and I'm just going to measure that. So we have 16.5 inches, so we're going to go to 8.25. And the same over this side, 8.25. And then we'll do two either side of the center one on both sides. So the good news here is we can use our standard kind of markup techniques, just pencil. So you don't have to dither around on a computer or anything. You basically just drop down plate and get to it. In this case, we're going to use the center and the fence on the bottom to get this aligned. So come in like so. Now I'm firmly butted up against that pencil mark and my little detail here shows me that I'm good. So I retract the fence. That's just a good thing to get into the habit of. Retract your reticle and fence whenever you're about to cut. Now I know I'm exactly aligned with this leading edge. And you'll see here we got the little markings where the center line here is 50 millimeters up from this edge. So that's actually perfect for what we want. Now I bring Origin into plate, and you'll notice the previous project I had set up here is ready to cut. We are going to adapt this. So I'm going to go back to workspaces, and I'm going to duplicate my clean setup one, and I'm going to rename it. So 32 millimeter centered. So this now has the center called out. It's 50 millimeters from that leading edge. So for the CIS 32 holes, there are 5 millimeter holes. So I'm going to drop the 1/8 inch cutter in there, and that'll be perfect for clearing out using the helix function. Keep in mind, if you're doing stuff resting on top of plate, obviously don't put sharp objects or sticky, messy objects on plate, but also just reconfirm that you're actually indexed correctly. Like, you don't want to bump this and then come back to it assuming you're well aligned. So plate will remain intact. Now I'm going to place my CIS32 hole file at the center. So I got a file here. Check the description below for the project, which is on ShapeUp. And what's cool about this is you notice I'm at -0.5 inch. I'm going to just put it to 0, 0. So that means I'm aligning this file right through the center of plate. And we know that that's 50 millimeters in from that fence reference point. And we've called out, you'll see here, the numbers of each one of these holes. So we can kind of keep track of where we are even when we're zoomed in a long way. So we go all the way up to 7, then we index and keep going. So I'm just going to use 5. So I'm going to start at 2 and go through to 6. Now I've just placed plate on here and changed my cutter. So let's quickly do a Z-touch. I'll go to cut mode. I'll tell it we have a 1/8 inch cutter. And then that's going to direct me to do a Z-touch. I have the pressure sensor over the flat area of plate, and my cutter itself is touching the wood itself. So just make sure you're not in a gap there, and make sure your pressure bar is supported. So I'm going to go from 2 through to 6. My depth, I can just set this to the total depth I want. So I'm going to do 0.5. So that's the maximum flute length of this particular cutter. It's going to cut down there with a spiral. Let's see how we go. So that's quick enough to be useful on one side, but when it gets really interesting is we flip this over and do the exact same thing on the other side. So this no longer requires any prep work. So we just align our fence to our reference mark there. Make sure we're indexed correctly. Retract the fence. So now every time I drop Origin on here, you'll notice our cuts are ready to go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So I once again, because we're symmetrical, I'm going to go from 2 to 6 on this side as well. I can just zoom out and keep an eye on that. I'm going to erase my cut history so that we know exactly where we are. Cut mode, helix, we are good to go. So there we go, 5 CIS32 holes, 50 millimeters from the edge, center line on our pencil mark on both sides. Just double check everything's in order before you move plate. So that's ready to be assembled, and our shells will slot right in on that as designed. So we're just going to do a quick roundover here, a 1-inch radius roundover, and plate's super quick for that once we set it up. So deploy the flags, so that gets us our edge of the stock referenced, and then we'll deploy the fence, and that gets us the bottom edge of the stock. So we know exactly where this corner is, and then push it up against there, retract the fence, and what we're going to see here is plate's a little bit unstable, right? So it's only supported on that side. This is a great situation where you would use the clamps. Now we're going to want to clamp perpendicular. If you check the manual, they recommend that, not at an angle. So we'll just come in here. One other thing to note, it's easy for the attachment point here to sort of get off the edge. You want to make sure it's pushed all the way to the back so that it's got a good amount of material to bind with and get you a good firm grip. We're not going to do it up crazy tight, but make sure it's seated properly. So I'm just doing it with my fingers there. We don't want to add a bow or any weird deflection to plate. And then we don't want to do this corner because we're going to use the strength of plate to support itself, but over here it'd be good as well. So that should firm things up. And then I'm going to make sure I'm seated all the way in to the end of my little keyhole slot. Then just do it up finger tight. Right, so with this clamped in place, we're going to probe a grid in this bottom left corner here. So we're actually going to probe on the stock, and because we indexed against it with our edge flags and our fence, we can precisely align to that consistently. And I'm going to go new, and I'm just going to look down the side and make sure my cutter's going into a nice gap. So this is the gap at the front, and I'm going to accept the depth, confirm my cutter's the right diameter, and then I'm just going to take it over here to about there, and probe it, lightly touch it, same as I always would, against the stock, and click probe one. And you'll notice we're probing the top edge, so that's correct. Be careful about going downwards towards the bottom. You could be scuffing up your plate. Just go towards the top, probe two, come around the edge. It's automatically updated to the right-hand side, which is actually what I want to do. And then we can just touch it there. Probe three, if I hold down, it stays plunged. Move it slightly off the edge and it'll retract without scuffing up my plate or the stock. Okay, so this is the first time I've created a grid in the bottom left corner. So I'm going to just go to workspaces and duplicate this workspace. So I can go here and I'm going to call this one. We'll move to that workspace. And I'm just going to give it a name. If I call everything plate at the beginning, I can search for all my plate projects easily. So I'm just going to quickly call this one plate 1-inch rad. Done. So we'll see the name update, and then when I save my file in there, that's going to be my go-to whenever I want to put a 1-inch radius on anything. Find that file now. I've just uploaded it to my Shaper Hub. Here we go, 1-inch corner round. And you'll see it's got a little custom anchor there, so it's going to be perfectly aligned. It's actually got little ease outs on both sides, which are kind of cool too. So I'm just going to place that down here at 0, 0. And now I'm confident. Zoom in there. Just got little reminders to stop cutting. So we just go from here to there and stop cutting there before we start cutting back into our material. Right, so we are good to go. Okay, so we've placed our file. We're going to quickly touch off here, just down the bottom, Z touch. Make sure your support bar is on the flat area here. If you ever have any problems, make sure plate isn't getting distorted. But as you see, we can touch off onto the surface itself that we intend to cut. That way every dimension we enter in our depth setting here is talking from that being zero. So we don't have to do any math to figure out how deep we're cutting. So I'll just air cut this and we can look on the screen at what we're going to do. So this little shape is a 1-inch corner radius. It's an outside cut. We start at the top corner here. Because we're air cutting, I can talk over it. So we don't want to start on the line that's coming out of the material. We start on the curved area. It's got a little ease in, and then from that blue line on, we're now radiusing material. So we'll be cutting, and then we come all the way to the bottom, and there's a little ease out. As a reminder, just stop there. Basically, I need to stop before Origin rounds that corner and starts going into material. So at that point, I stop, come in, and cut deeper. So then we just go through the motions, cutting as we always do in quarter-inch passes. This is obviously just MDF. We will form the cuts here, but this will work in any material that Origin's capable of cutting. So that's a pristine corner now. We got the perfect 1-inch radius. So if I was to cut this on the other corner here, I would just take plate off, rotate it around 90 degrees, drop it back down, and this file is already going to be perfectly aligned based on those flags and my fence. So even though we set this one up and named it and all that at the beginning, from this point on, we just go drop plate, cut, drop plate, cut. To make the most of plate, take a look at the hardware catalog on hub.shapertools.com/hardware. Everything you need with files prepped, ready to go, are up there. Just sync it to Origin, you'll be aligning it with plate and cutting precisely immediately. So when we look at the tape field, we're going to continue looking at the most recent plate workspaces. So if I'm doing a bunch of the same things over and over again, I'm going to remain in that project. So because we just completed the corner radius, we're looking at that plate corner radius workspace. Now I'm going to go and find my bottom center plate. So I'm going to duplicate this. And then up the top here, I'm going to go into that workspace and we are good to go. So that one's designed to align me at the very center because I've already gridded that. I'm ready to go. And then we'll import our hardware file we just synced from ShaperHub, SOS 101, select. So this has all the offsets I need. I just place it at 0, 0. So that's the point at the very bottom of our stock. And you'll see it's got a little offset baked in, which is the appropriate offset for the SOS 101. I select place, and then I just follow the instructions. This first one's just telling me use a quarter inch cutter, and I'm going to 0.45 deep for that deep one. This other one is quarter inch cutter 0.219. So go to cut, choose 0.219, and then we just cut. couple of notes there. In terms of technique, I was doing a lot of auto mode around those corners, and I was keeping my hands kind of firmly pressed down against the plate. So I want to make sure I'm getting sort of maximum friction on the bottom of it, and I'm not sort of pulling plate out of alignment. Now, you'll notice I haven't moved plate. I'm just going to test fit these to see if that's the appropriate size. They will fit in. That's a pretty firm fit. I could take some more off if I wanted. I might just put in a 0.00, so 3/1000ths negative offset. So I'm just taking a tiny amount of extra material off. So that's the exact friction fit we want. And we're perfectly aligned, perfectly straight to the edge. So where plate starts to come into its own is now I've set that up. And we can just keep going. We just drop plate down, align with the pencil line, and then continue cutting as we did previously. So because this moves with my plate, wherever I place this, you know, you see my file is aligned to plate, but because plate is aligned to the stock, this comes along for the ride. For this demo, we're going to install the little L37 brusso hinge, little leaf hinge thing that goes about there like so. To set plate up, I've just got it with some double-sided tape behind it there. You might want to make a fixture or something if you're doing a whole bunch of it. Basically, we're just going to use this fence leading edge to index and center like so. So as long as I press firmly, make sure that's all clean, retract my fence. Now we're good to go. So the friction of the non-slip mat on the back will hold that in place. So you'll notice what I'm seeing is what I originally scanned for my plate, and that was just on a flat surface. So I'm not seeing this little detail. There's a couple of things I can do. I can either do an add to scan here. So I can go scan, add to scan, and then I just come over here, look straight down and go start, finish. Now you'll notice that's gonna give me an updated view of what this actually looks like. So that's a great option that lets me know how it's set up. I can also, if I wanna make this apparent for future projects, I can just put this little guy in here where it's going to be and do an add to scan there. Scan, add to scan, start scan, finish. So there's the actual hardware where it's going to go approximate. So that's a good little, just a tip. And you can even do things like if you're going to be doing a bunch of this, I could go design, create, text, brusso L37. Done. So now that's just a reminder to me, this is the brusso L37. So then, you know, we can see from a bigger distance, like exactly what it is we're installing. So I'm going to install the file, import the file, and I've got one set up here just the way I like it. And you'll notice I'm 1/2 inch to the right at the moment. So the good news about this is I can approximately line things up with my image and know I'm in the ballpark. So there goes my actual file precisely aligned. It's centered along the rotating, the center of my pivot for that hinge. So that should be perfect, just like that. Now, I haven't done a touch off yet, so I'm going to do that. And I'm going to trigger it just by telling it what size cutter I'm using, 1/4 inch, Z-touch, keep my hands off origin and plate. Once again, I've got the pressure sensor in the front supported. Now this is going to clear out everything, except you'll see in these corners here, I'm going to have to chisel out that to make it nice and square. I just checked my info, cutter diameter, 1/4 inch to 8 mm works. So we're good there. And then the cut depth is going to be 1/8 inch. And we're good to go. So as with most of these things, it's designed to be kind of an interference fit by default, super tight. We might actually make that work. And then I just need to come through here and chisel out these end details. Keep in mind, you wouldn't move plate until you're satisfied with your positioning and fit. So then for the default installation, that should just drop straight in there as intended. Obviously, you can make little micro adjustments, like these can be adjusted to get the door to sit true. So depending on what side you're working on, you know, you can inch sideways tiny amounts, and plate can sort of help you with that. That's a perfectly installed brusso L37.